Welcome to the MICK Show, where I give you a laid-back look at the lives and businesses of today's most well-respected creatives. You'll learn key life lessons from culture's most prominent personalities, musicians, actors, athletes, and CEOs. So sit back, relax, and let's get into the show. This is the MICK Show. Welcome back to the MICK Show. This is episode 4, this time with my good friend Ros Gold-Onwude. You may recognize her from being courtside as the voice of the Warriors during Steph Curry's rise to fame. Perhaps you saw her the last couple years on TNT doing amazing basketball analysis, and now you can catch her on ESPN and many other platforms. This is the perfect time to have Ros on our show. It's the NBA Finals. Everyone's in a bubble. Life is kind of crazy. We're going to talk about sports. We're going to talk about Nigeria. We're going to talk about her Stanford education and a bunch of other amazing things. I'm so excited to welcome Ros to the show. And before we get into that, please do me a favor. If you love the MICK Show, wherever you listen to your favorite podcast, rate us, give us stars, leave us a review, subscribe, tell your friends. We can only grow with your support. Thank you so much for doing that, and with no more ado, let's get into the show. This is episode 4 of The MICK Show. Welcome back to The MICK Show. I'm very excited for my special guest. Man, this is a person who is actually a real-life friend, as well as a legend in sports, entertainment, journalism, TV, media. My friend Ros Gold-Onwude. Did I say it right? How close did I get?
No, that was good.
All right. My Nigerian's a little iffy, so.
Well, you got the first part right, which is the easy part, gold. And the last part well too. So that's the Russian, Polish, Jewish gold. And then the Onwude is my dad. He's Nigerian, and that's Onwude.
I love it. I am all about mixed kids. it's my specialty, so it's great. So
Miles, your baby boy, he's so cute. Anytime I see a picture of him, it just warms my heart.
I made that. He's my bestie. He just turned 5, so it's crazy. Like, he's like an adult, and he loves basketball. So we put a basketball hoop in the backyard, and he's playing, and it's really cool. I did my reading on you, even though it's the things I didn't know. You got into basketball via your mom when you were 4.
Yeah.
Is that correct? Yeah. So like Nardwar or whatever, like these random weird facts. But let's talk about that. Like, how did that happen? And did you know when you were introduced to, I mean, I guess at the time it was just a sport, but it wasn't really a culture like it is now. But did you know that it would be a transformative experience in your life?
At 4? No. And I, to be quite honest, I'm not even sure my mom knew that getting me involved in sports and one day basketball would turn into a vehicle that allowed me to go to college for free, that allowed me to see the world, that eventually gave me a career that I love and many of my lifelong friends, you know, that I now consider family. My mom was not an athlete. The athleticism probably came more from my dad on the Nigerian side, but my mom was kind of nerdy, kind of quirky growing up and wasn't so athletic, but she had passion for women's rights. And, you know, even when she was at college, she went to SUNY Albany in New York. We're New Yorkers, we're from Queens. You know, she wrote articles about the women's soccer teams or the different sports there. So when she had 2 daughters, she was in Queens using like MS Paint. She would make little flyers with stick figures.
Wow, MS Paint. We got to just call that out. MS Paint, Microsoft Paint.
That's a throwback. And that's how my mom was really out here with like stick figures and made a little ball and made signs that she pasted along the streets of the LIE and Harris Harding Expressway and Left Rack City and Regal Park, Queens, saying, moms, you know, parents, bring your daughters to, at the time it was a CYO league at Our Lady of the Angelus, and was helpful in creating girls basketball leagues that were still not as popular as they are today. And, you know, from there instilled passion in the game for me and drove me all around, you know, the country eventually and helped me get recruited for college. And so
that's a great mom. I love that. And then, you know, what else were you into as a kid? Like, what else? Cause I'm wondering, like, were you super into music? Were you super into TV? Like, what, cause these things obviously all in informing how your career netted out.
I was more about playing, and I played everything. I mean, I played softball, I ran track, I played basketball, which I eventually focused in on. I played piano for 8 years. So I definitely think that helps me now with an ear, an eclectic taste for all types of music. I can still read music. And I think for the most part, growing up with an immigrant, you know, parent, I know a lot of my immigrant friends have similar stories. You know, I was really focused on the books and doing well in school and really focused on my basketball and doing well at that. And once I got older and more, once I finished college is when I really started to blossom as a woman with many interests. One, that comes with experience and maturity, and two, with just starting to live my life for myself and seeing more of the world. And so I'm into music. I love art. I love traveling. I like, although that's not happening as much in COVID, I like to eat. I'm enjoying cooking more, you know, and I enjoy my village and my people like you, Mick, my friends and family.
I love it. One of the coolest things, I remember seeing it before on IG, but when doing another little deep dive before we did this, you had like an iconic photo of you with the cut near your eye. I love that. It shows resilience. It shows pushing through. It shows, I don't give a fuck what you're going to try to do to me. Like, I'm going to get my shit done regardless. But the photo really, really stuck out to me because it was such a juxtaposition. How do you deal with when life gives you little quick jabs, and how do you recover from that?
Well, I can tell you, I think I know the photo you're talking about, and I'm pretty sure during the game, I wasn't even aware of the cut. I'm out here, probably a guard. I'm a guard, 5'10". I'm a big guard at 5'10". But, you know, probably tussling with the big girls inside, and I should have been minding my business. Somebody probably knocked me. But it definitely shows a resilience. I think it definitely comes from how my parents raised me. It definitely comes from growing up in New York, growing up in a city, playing ball, having to earn my own, you know, at parks. And, you know, and just in life, I've never been a quitter. You talk about what you do when you hit jabs. Man, 2020 been jabbing all of us. Man. I feel like right now I'm constantly having talks like, you ain't weak, Rez. Come on. Like every morning I'm in the mirror like, you ain't weak. You got this. Like, it's a pep talk. It's like, I feel like I have fought 1,000 battles, lived 1,000 lives in 2020. And there are certainly days of it's hard on all of us. And I think a lot of that could be whether you're dealing with, you know, actual circumstances that are affecting your day to day, or it might just be like the potential of it all. Like for me, you know, the ambiguity of it all is very hard for me. That's not my strength. And so continuing, even on the days that you're your lowest, like continuing to just, all right, I'm coming back at this. What can I control? You know, I like to make my list. I'm being proactive. I'm being aggressive. I'm being thoughtful. I'm also minding my wellness. I'm making time for outdoors activities. I'm making time to communicate with humans. Sometimes I'm so busy trying to get to the action and hustling that I go through a whole day and I realize, dog, I haven't spoken to a human being. I haven't seen a human being today. And, you know, all of that can affect you. So
and when you do see them, they're wearing a mask. Yeah. So you're only seeing half of them anyways.
You don't even feel them. You don't even feel them, you know? Like, I'm enjoying, this counts as my human interaction for today.
Nice, nice. I'm gonna send you a bell.
You my therapist today?
Yeah. We will be each other's therapist because this is like, this becomes, I think that's the beauty. I mean, obviously you see it all the time, just doing journalism and sports journalism. Like, I think a lot of times I aspire to have the ability to pull answers out of people to the level of how you guys do. And I think about, you know, we are friends and this was an easy ask for me to get you to come on this. But like, when I think about like how people interview athletes at the end of a game where they're drained after 3 hours of crazy, you know, this isn't somebody waking up on Sunday after 12 hours of sleep with a nice breakfast sitting on their deck, answering questions. Your job is to pull out these amazing moments from them. And it's just like, it's incredible. So when I was researching like some of your education stuff, because I noticed some similarities between our lives and that. I mean, I don't have a Stanford education. So I took 3 days of a class at Harvard, though. That's all I got. But what I thought was interesting was, you know, our careers are similar in a lot of ways in that we are our own brands, right? Yeah. And our personal brand always will stand in front of whoever we're working for, whether you're with a TV network, whether I'm DJing for a celebrity or whatever it is. Like, it's our personal brand that got us in the room. And it's the personal brand that'll keep us in the room. And I thought what was really interesting was like your background, you have a master's in sociology.
Yes.
And that's not probably very common in people talking NBA players. I would assume it's probably a rare thing. And it's like, I have an MBA and that's highly rare in DJing. But I feel like my shit helps me night and day comparatively because it gives me I have a different operating system than my peers. And I was wondering if you felt the same way.
I think so. I mean, I definitely think that there is use, especially for the courses I took around, you know, how people think, you know, new trends in technology. My focus was more around business organizations and the economy. So actually a lot of those types of things that I studied at Stanford have become very relevant now as people are talking about pay equity between men and women, talking about systemic oppression and racism in the workplace. These are the types of things that I studied in school. Some of the courses I took too, I had a communication undergrad degree and we did a lot of it was technology based about like interfaces and how people react to them and artificial intelligence. A lot of that I'm kind of seeing come to fruition and to life now. Wow. And I remember the studies and the professors and, you know, the leaders of those industries sharing their knowledge. And so that has been helpful. But I think when I was deciding what to do with my life, I wanted to stay close to the game that I love, that I've been playing since I was four. And I, you know, started building while I was in college. And that was working at the school production radio station as a production assistant. I was teaching a public speaking course. I was doing, you know, little interviews on gostanford.com, you know, of the different athletes and stuff around campus. And I was shadowing people. Not to mention, I've always had a New York hustle. I was working at Nike, you know, doing internships every summer. And it's crazy because a lot of the people I met at Nike during those two internships, I swear to God, I see them all the time on game day. And it's like it's a family, you know, you sports world is small. I mean, we've seen each other how many times in the sports world, like different events, All-Star Weekend, you know, eventually step by step started to build in broadcasting, which I'm sure just like in the entertainment and music business for you, you're doing a lot for nothing early. It's a grind. And, you know, with reps, you get better and good timing and good networking and, you know, good work, you know, you can hopefully, you know, continue to rise. So that's how I found my way here. I think what helps me be successful to finish out your question in interviews is one, I played the game and there's a common ground and a respect there. But two, you know, learning the skill set, like for me, learning how to listen within the interview, especially post-game interviews, it's a lot of pressure to get this done in a finite amount of time and to execute this properly. I actually find the interviews that I'm doing during the pandemic have been some of the best because dudes are at home and relaxed versus, you know, I've got 10 minutes with you, you know, after practice or, you know, a minute 30 or 80 seconds after the game, you know. So even though those moments are quick, because they are so quick, the goal is perfection. And they often feel like Super Bowls for me. It takes quite a bit of concentration, focus, execution, listening, preparation to know where to go after the first question. Right. To the second.
Because you don't know where they're going. They're probably super wild cards at that moment, right?
I would say there's many roles within broadcasting. There's hosting where, you know, I might moderate and move the conversation along with my analyst. There's being the analyst or the personality. And I find, well, you have to do a lot of work to be able to speak at length, you know, to do this, you know, and then there's also a skill set of delivery, like the Stephen A. Smiths of the world and beyond. That's actually very comfortable because you just get to speak and be yourself. There's not as much time limit. If you mess up, you have a chance to fix it. And then I actually find the reporter role sometimes is the hardest skill set and the least amount of glory. You're on for like a minute, seconds, whatever at a time. It's very structured in the format. And, you know, sometimes, especially in the interviews, you can get shit on and you don't even have a chance to really get out of it. Like, you know,
you just got to take it. You just got to walk out of there with it on you.
Yeah. You know, so I've done all the roles and I find that there is excitement in all the different roles. And so I continue to try to build my career with as much versatility as possible.
I love that, especially if this year has taught us nothing. It's that, like, you know, versatility is what will enable us to, you know, thrive and succeed, grow, expand. Because, you know, so right now everyone's in this bubble and it's just like, it's so crazy watching basketball now with everybody, like with nobody in the arena. And then they put those people up on the wall, which is like really funny to me. And I love the fact that they have like empty seats sometimes. Yeah.
Why would they do that?
I'm sitting here with no job. I'm like, that could be my job. I could find people to go in those seats. Like there's, I don't know how many seats there are, but it can't be that hard.
So I'm curious, Nick, because you're talking to the wrong one. I am not the casual basketball fan. I watch all levels. I could sit at a park and watch, you know, everyday people hoop, you know, to a game of 11. So actually, I personally have found the bubble games and the entertainment aspect of it. Actually, I'm impressed. I think the games have been excellent. And I find that the fans, you know, the way we see it on TV, I think it feels big for what it is. I'm curious for you, how does it seem?
I agree. I think it does feel big. I just more so find it funny that like they just have empty seats when there's only like 30 seats. Like it's just like that's just funny. I actually find watching basketball in the bubble more fascinating. I find it more cinematic. I see different angles and I see, you know, it is a little bit more manufactured as far as like the background and the noise and the ambiance. Yeah. So, but it also enables you to focus a lot more on the ball because like what else would you be, you know, focusing on? And I think it does for all the extra bells and whistles they're trying to add in order to create this entertainment value, what they're really doing is still just, it's just distilling your focus on one thing and one thing only, which is basketball. And if you're a true hoops fan, like obviously you are, and I am, and most of our friends are, it's like March Madness for months. There's like four games a day. There's like games on at 1:30. There's games on at like 5:30. It's just like insane.
Right. And you know, I think anytime you can add urgency, it's exciting. So the play-in game for the playoffs, you know, that even just who would get the final seed for the play-in.
Yeah.
Thrilling. The play-in game itself was exciting. I would not be surprised if we saw that executed in the future, COVID or not. You know, I think it's been important, the success of the NBA and the WNBA. Let's also point both leagues out because as of the last few tests now, I think the last four for the NBA, at least the last two or three for the WNBA, there's been reports as of this taping of no positive COVID coronavirus cases. And I believe that the NBA and NBPA, Players Association, have worked together to create more affordable, more available, faster testing practices as well that would be available to the American community and, you know, and are working towards that. So there's a lot that can be learned for society's benefit. They're working with that Aura ring. They're working with different types of procedures. As it continues to happen successfully with good planning, good execution, and most importantly, great buy-in from the collection of all the people there, these things can be implemented in society and at minimum, certainly to other sports leagues that have the ability and have to have the money to be able to execute a bubble. It ain't cheap.
I mean, I learned I could go to a strip club and get chicken and not get COVID. And my pandemic was made. I'm great.
Phenomenal. Yo, but that'll only further Lou Will's legend over time. Like, honestly, like, we'll never tell the story the way it was told, that he went home to honor, you know, a loved one who had passed away. And on his way back, he stopped for food. The way this story will go down in infamy, and we already know Lou Will is low-key a legend, like a culture
legend. Legend.
Like, it'll go down like, this man left the bubble to get some chicken.
Yeah, there's no way that story gets told any other way. That made me think about, like, you know, like teams and structure and how people relate, especially when something like that happens. You had the privilege to be on the sidelines for the rise of the Warriors.
Yep.
You know, they gave themselves a lot of credit for how great their culture was. The owners gave themselves a lot of credit for our businesses. What do they say? Like light years ahead of everything. And so I think about this as an entrepreneur and I think about it as a creative and you know, they were right. You know, it crushed. When you're on the inside, or at least like as close to the inside as you were in that scenario, what did you notice that set them apart organizationally?
Yeah, it starts from the top. I think there was great transparency and communication from like literally the top down. You know, Mr. Lacob was at, you know, all the games. You know, fans could see him, employees could see him. You know, Rick Welts, the president, is someone who made himself readily available to speak with anybody within the organization and try to be a great asset and mentor and ear for them. You know, and I think the organization has fought for a lot of different underserved groups or traditionally oppressed groups, whether that be for the gay and lesbian community and beyond and trans, and or whether that be for minorities or even, you know, in the Bay Area, there's lots of different types of minorities. You know, there's obviously Black, there's Latino, but, you know, there's Filipinos, there's an Asian population, just everybody was well recognized and treated well. I also think it starts with your star. You know, your superstar is Stephen Curry. Steph's a better person than he is a player. And this right. man is going to go down as a Hall of Famer, maybe one of the greatest point shooter of all time. You know, the top point guard in the league right now. You could argue that, you know, Steph and his whole entire family are beautiful people. He is exactly what you see. A family man. You know, Steph has time to speak with the president of the organization. He has time to speak with a part-time janitor in the organization. He has eye contact for you. You see him, he remembers the last time you spoke to him. And he works hard and he's giving and kind. And so if your superstar is leading that way, everybody else better get in line. And so I think a lot of the success starts with the successful culture of the business organization, but certainly a big part of it too is when Stephen Curry is your leader, everyone else will follow in that same kind of culture and passion that he delivered.
Can we share our random funny friendship moment when you sent me a text once for something you needed to do for Steph? Can we share that story?
Oh my God. Yes. Okay.
I've never told that story. This just seems like a perfect lead into that. So let me set it up. Last year was sitting in my tub late night in some bubbles. It was a beautiful night by myself. And yeah. I got a text from the person that's on this podcast with me. And it's like, I need a favor. what was that favor?
Yo, it was crazy. I really hit you on some crazy stuff. Basically, I had moved on. I had got a new opportunity after having the blessing of covering the Warriors through championships and finals appearances. I got an opportunity to...
Not just a blessing. You also earned it and put yourself in a place to get there. So let's give you a lot of credit in this too.
Thank you, sir. And got my first national opportunity and got to cover the entire NBA, the entire league. So about the second year into it, and this was probably last year, yeah?
I think it was last year. Yeah. Yes.
So, you know, the Warriors are forever going to be my family. And I was going to bring my family in Orlando to go see a Warriors Magic game when the Warriors came to town. And they all took care of my tickets. And, you know, I knew that I wanted, you know, to bring my little, we'll call them niece and nephew babies, basically to come meet the players. And, you know, it's hard to meet Steph after the game too, because, you know, while he's so willing and giving, he's being pulled 1,000 directions, you know? And so you don't want to do too much. And also he really is already giving so much of himself. So you may not be able to catch him. This time I knew I was going to see Steph, and he just, I actually wrote him a note with the gift that I got from Mick. And I said, now that I've covered the rest of the league, you know, the Warriors were my first NBA team. I didn't know you were my first superstar and I was spoiled. Not every superstar, not that they're bad, but you know, not everybody is Stephen Curry.
Yeah, you started up there.
With as far as his accessibility and sweetness and kindness and care, you know, just not every person is like that. So I was like, man, you spoiled me. And I just wanted to say thank you for being a great human. So I wanted to get him a gift. What can I get Stephen Curry, who's already got it all? So I hit up one of his boys, and his best friend, actually. And I was like, hey, what can I get Steph? What does he like? And I know he likes scotch. Steph is a big scotch fan. What's his favorite scotch? And the first brand he told me was like wildly expensive. Like we're, you know, just couldn't do it. You know, that'd be like a paycheck, you know, or something. So then he was like, I was like, could you recommend some other scotches? And he had said, you know, there's this, and then there's a really nice Japanese whiskey that's actually a scotch or something. So I go and research it, and actually there's none in the Orlando area. And where I could find it, there was one in like a remote store in New York. So I said, who do I know in New York? And it was Brooklyn, actually. Yeah. So I think I really was like, who could I even ask? And I was like, I don't know why. I was just like, yo, Mick, you live in Brooklyn, right?
and through the bubbles, I typed, I do. And the next day I went on like the wild goose chase.
I was like, yo, so here's the deal. I was like, yo, I want to give Steph a gift. There's like one bottle available in a random store in Brooklyn. Will you pick it up and mail it to me in Orlando so I can gift it to him? So Mick picked up the bottle of this exclusive, like nice Scotch Japanese whiskey. I have no idea.
It's so funny because I remember picking that up, and then I picked it up and there was a UPS store like four stores down from that. And I just remember thinking like, my God, if the guy at that store, who obviously is probably a huge NBA fan, and the kid at the UPS store who's mailing that, and if they knew the behind the scenes that I was going into a liquor store to get a bottle for somebody who's a nationally known broadcaster that they watch every day to send to one of the greatest players to ever play. And then when I walk in the UPS store and he saw the, here's a funny fact, but they saw the bag and he's like, what's in this bag? Because you can't just send like liquor like that to the UPS store. Like, okay. It's like all this. He's like, what's in that bag? And I'm like, and I'm bald, right? So for people who don't know, I'm like bald. So I'm just like, hair conditioner? And the guy was like, hair conditioner. And I'm like, hair conditioner. He's like, all right, bro. So I love it. So we'll always be connected by that. I know you got to go shortly. So we're going to end with, there's a thing we do on this podcast. It's similar to a game of horse, if you will, to use a basketball motto. And we do a game of Mick. And what we do is four quick questions utilizing the really annoying letters in my name. So M, music. What is one song that has significant meaning to you?
The most meaningful song is actually one my mom used to sing to me as a little girl. It's called, I think, Que Sera, but it's like whatever will be. And actually, I had no idea, but it's actually a Doris Day song. I thought my mother made it up, but my mom used to sing it to me. And the song is about not worrying so much about what the future holds, you know, and just taking peace and calm and, you know, whatever will be, you know, the future's not ours to see.
I love that. Here I am thinking you're going to go with some like Burner Boy or like some like crazy.
Oh, I like Burner though. Look, Burner new album is everything. And I actually think his previous album, African Giant, is actually, I think that was the best album of 2019. The way he uses his voice as an instrument, the actual instruments in it. There's nothing currently that sounds like Burner Boy. And I think he really had a major moment worldwide.
For sure. I mean, I can't even imagine. I mean, he elevated it to another. I mean, it was already elevating, but he elevated it to.
I just feel like that was.
And if it didn't elevate, Drake was going to make sure that it got elevated. And then Drake's going to be doing Que Sera Sera next year once he hears this.
Right,
the British drill, the London drill version of Que Sera.
No, Drake would make Que Sera like my mom's bedtime medley to us into a hit, man. He rarely misses if he does.
I love it. Okay. If you could fix one world problem, what would it be?
Voting. That's right. My issue right now. That's on my heart and chest at the time of this taping. Voter suppression is wildly frustrating for me. And I before I moved to LA, I was living in Atlanta, and I remember waiting hours and hours to get my vote in, and in a place where my vote really counted quite a bit. You know, just how frustrating it is to see that, you know, this is continuing today in a place where democracy, we're supposed to be the leaders of that. And also, I'd like to just see more of, you know, all the communities to exercise their power in voting, young people, minority groups, you know, it's so needed right now. Look, I'm going to respect your politics, but I do feel that if it's a real democracy, we should all have the opportunity to get our votes and, you know, what we care about. Dude, we've got fake fans at the bubble for the NBA. We're doing all sorts of crazy things, and we can't figure out a high-tech voting situation. Like, what?
Yeah, that's kind of wild. Well, I mean, fake fans that don't show up, just like the voting situation.
Right.
All right. C, craziest risk you've ever taken.
Was it
worth it?
Okay. I went hang gliding in Brazil. And I went off of the Dos Hermanos mountains, I think, the two brothers one. And in order to do that, my friends were doing, this is not something I would ever want to do. My friends were doing it. And so I went, not really understanding what it was. We hiked to the top, and then you literally run off the cliff and jump with the hang glide and then float.
Wow.
And in the training, the professional is telling you, whatever you do, do not stop. When we run, you must run and jump off. If you stop, we won't have the momentum to take off and we'll fall. He's like, he's freaking me out. He's telling me like past people have died. I'm like, bro, the energy is wrong right now. Like, yo, we got to bring positivity to this. All my friends were like having fun, laughing and taking selfies. My guy's freaking me out. So we're finally running off the cliff. And he's like, don't stop, run, run. And I'm running as fast as I can. And we jump and we make it. And actually the hardest part was jumping off. And the actual hang gliding in the air feels like floating like a feather. Was it worth it? No.
Oh, it's not what I thought you could say.
And we softly land on the beach. And like, that was kind of cool. But I was like, I could have also done without that.
That's hilarious. I really thought you were, I thought you were going to be like, and ever since then, it was the cheat codes in my career and all my degrees. And
transformational. Like, I don't think I would do it again. It was fine, but.
You're like, nah, I would have just got some Brazilian food and sat on the beach, just chilled out.
Good.
I love it. Okay. And the last thing that we'll do is K. Key life lesson you'll always carry with you from someone you admire.
A key life lesson for me is like, you know, the power of your village. Your true wealth will be in the people around you. And I find that you can't really navigate this life successfully, consistently, and long-term trying to do it alone. You really need to be there for other people and allow other people to be there for you and invest in your friendships and family and loved ones. And that's one of the greatest investments that you'll see return from.
That's great. Ros, you're a legend. I'm so grateful, A, for you to be like a real life human friend and B, now a guest on this, you know, debut season of The Mick Show as I try to enter your world of journalism from my little fake office in my house. It's so much easier to record these when I don't have my kid here, by the way. It's just like, it's crazy. Like he's popped in. Like, I mean, it's just an insane thing, but you know, thankfully he's cute and people like it. But we will link to all your amazing stuff when this comes out, and we're so grateful for you for taking the time out. I know your schedule is very hectic with all the stuff going on right now.
Right. Well, I wish you the best during this time, and thank you for having me on. Follow your girl at Rosgo21, and Mick, you did a great job. You could transition into this if you want to. So I'm proud of you. And you
know, I just want somebody to send me whiskey one day, man. That's like, if I could get that, then I'm good. Ros, thank you so much. You're truly the best. Best of luck to you in you know, the playoffs and covering it and next year and all the good stuff. And we will talk soon. Thank you so much. And that was it for another episode of The Mick Show. Thank you all so much for tuning in. We sincerely appreciate it. Please, please, please do us a favor. Wherever it is that you listen to your favorite podcast, please, please subscribe to The Mick Show. Like The Mick Show. Write a review for The Mick Show. Leave a star rating for The Mick Show. Whatever you can do helps. 5 stars would be amazing. 4 stars would be cool. 4.5. I was never an A-plus student in school. I was like that B-plus guy. So anything in that range, more than grateful for. Also, make sure you follow on social, Instagram at Mick, Twitter at I am Mick. Let me know who you want to see on a future episode of The Mick Show so we can try to get them on for you. Again, thank you all so much for tuning in, and we will see you back here next week.